Okay friends, welcome to this lecture, and in this lecture we are going to discuss something more detailed of the application of electrical stimulation. Why is electrical stimulation applied at last? So electrical stimulation is applied, as we saw, to restore muscle properties. So what can be the possible causes of changes or deterioration in the muscle properties? The first cause can be during immobilization. Post fracture or post joint injuries or post traumatically, normally the patient is put in immobilization for a certain amount of time till the inflammatory process starts healing and remodeling. So the person is kept into immobilization. What immobilization does? Because there is no movement in the muscle, there is no shortening and lengthening of the muscle. So this can actually cause a weakness in the sliding filament theory, in the sliding or the contraction and expansion of the muscle. It can also cause the reduction in the muscle protein, thereby causing a wasting of muscle or a thinning of muscle, right? So what can happen with during immobilization? The muscle fiber can get thinner and it can get weaker because it is not having the full length of contraction that is actually allowed in the muscle. Secondly, if the muscle is immobilized in a shortened position, so the muscle tends to go in a contractile position. There is fibrosis in the muscle and it can go into contraction or contracture or shortened position because of immobilization. So at this point of time also, to cause a artificial contraction in the muscle, we can go for electrical stimulation. The second thing is senile weakness, that is weakness related to old age. In certain inactive individuals who are not very active in their old age, we tend to see, there have been studies that show that at an old age there is reduction in the contraction of the muscle and in the latency period of the muscle increases, of reaction increase, the reactivity of muscle goes down. So this can also be one cause of muscle weakness or cut down or compromised muscle function, right? The next is spinal cord injury. Spinal cord injury is L1 injury at that point where below the point of injury, right? So it causes paralysis of the muscle. We know this very well. So spinal cord injury induced paralysis of the muscle can also be a cause where the muscle is going for fibrosis or inactivity, where the muscle loses its contractile properties, and to maintain them we have to go for electrical stimulation of the muscle. Then in stroke. Stroke, you know what is stroke? Stroke is a hemorrhagic or ischemic injury to the brain, and this can affect the coordination of the muscle overall, leading to weakness of the antagonist as well as the agonist group of muscles. The agonist, that is actually because of central nervous system injury, it will go for spasticity. But the antagonist, so the extensors in the arm and the flexors in the leg, normally tend to go for weakness. They are not under the effect of paralysis, but they go for weakness because of the contracture of the other group of muscle or the agonist group of muscles. So here also we can use this thing even to reduce the spasticity also. Nowadays the studies are going on and we are using electrical stimulation on the spastic muscles to reduce their spasticity or to gain back their voluntary control. So this is known as the use of the loss of muscle and muscle properties in stroke. Then there is the neuromuscular disorders that can be seen in children, either which can be congenital or something. So it has been proven that giving a appropriate amount of current with the appropriate surge stimulation to the kid can lead to improvement in patients with DMD or muscular dystrophies or any other associated problems, right? So we can use it in NMDs also. And the last thing is nerve injury. Now, nerve injury, there are three types of nerve injuries, the neuropraxia, the neurotemesis, and the exenatemesis. So, neurotemesis is a complete cut of nerve with the axon and the myelin sheath. So, there probably you cannot help. But in a neuropraxia, where there is a transient compression on the nerve, or neurotemesis, where the axon sheath is intact but the nerve fiber is cut, we can have some use of electrical stimulation in maintaining the muscle properties till the neuron undergoes the degeneration and the Wallerian degeneration and regeneration cycle. Right? So these are certain causes which can actually lead to changes in muscle properties and which will need the use of electrical stimulation for their recovery. Okay, so moving to next part in this. So with this, what can be the probable indications? What can be the indications for electrical stimulation? So the indications for electrical stimulation can be where you need a muscle contraction. Okay. So you need a muscle contraction in a lower motor neuron injury. Right? It can be a LMN injury. Then it can be re-education of muscle. A muscle has got paralyzed because of any reason, and then you want the muscle to recover, so you are re-educating the muscle, right? So there you can use it. You can use it for retraining, right? Retraining after a tendon transfer. The muscle tendon has been transferred and the new action has to be taught to the muscle. So in retraining also you can use this particular thing, right? Then you can use it in neuropraxia, right? So we can use it in neuropraxia where there is a temporary contraction of the muscle and then we can use it over there also. Then we can use it in I'll just rub it off because as it goes down my writing goes a little bit bad, so I'll just take it down, right? Then there can be a muscle repair. The muscle has got injured and the muscle is getting repaired, and there we are use it, right? So there also we can use this for treatment. And then there can be something that we call as muscle strengthening, right? This is also one place where we can use electrical muscle stimulation. Other than this, few things also, there are number of things that are given over here depending on the effects of muscle. So we'll know that as we go beyond. It can also be used for assisting lymphatic or venous drainage, right? Because when we stimulate the muscle, it causes a pumping action. So that causes a return of blood or increased movement of blood. So it can even be used as assisting lymph and venous drainage also. Other than this also, any type of injury other than a complete devoid of supply from the muscle. Only and only if there is something that we call as a neurotemesis, right? other than this neurotemesis in any problem related to muscle contraction because of injury to the nerve or to the muscle itself can be treated with this. Any injury to the neuromuscular junction can also be treated with this, but in control and with the help of assistance of medicines which are going to provide sufficient amount of environment in the body, and then we need a surging of current to use this, right? So now next one topic, very fast I'll take in this, that I'll cover in this, is the surge current we use are used as waveforms, right? And the waveforms that are used are triangular, right? That is, it raises, drops, and there is a phase, raises, drops, and phase, raises, drops, and phase. There can be a triangular waveform, there can be a rectangular waveform, that is, it raises and down, and again it raises, maintains, and down, raises and maintains for some times and goes down, and then there can be a trapezoidal waveform that raises slowly, maintains, and goes down, slowly down, slowly down, right? So there are these various forms of waveforms that can be used when we are using a surge ferritic current for stimulation. So it can be a triangular waveform which rises slowly and goes down slowly. There can be a rectangular waveform which rises abruptly, then stays high up to certain level and drops down abruptly. Then there is a trapezoidal which rises slowly, it stays there for some time, and then it tapers down slowly, right? So these are the various waveforms that we use when we are using the surge ferritic current. These are based on the stimulation time and the rest time and the rise time and the low time of the muscle. These are parameter settings which can be used when using electrical muscle stimulation, which you will be taught in your practical class. Okay, so these are the types of waveforms that are used. Now in the next lecture we are going to discuss about the effects of muscle stimulation. So till here you revise it, you can open your books and read from it also to take an idea. You can see what I am giving you is a introduction and idea of the subject on a whole, and you have to be specific when you want to write in the exams or when you want to use this in appearing in the exam. So I request you that after each lecture you should open whichever book you are referring and try to read that particular information from that book. It might so happen that I would have forgotten some point, or I would have been jumbled up with certain point. If it is so, do not carry the same thing with you. You can just correct it in your own mind, right? And you can make it correct and you can read it from book, do a revision, and then we switch to the next lecture. So don't just sit and listen these lectures as a series of YouTube videos. You have to get involved into it, you have to make notes from it, and you keep your books together so that you correlate and you keep on revising the concepts as we are covering them. Okay, so next class we'll be moving to process of muscle stimulation, what is the procedure and what are the effects, physiological effects of muscle stimulation. Okay, see you.